Welcome to the Cult Classic Horror Show. Every week, you can have the conversations you've always wanted to have about the films you love.
Shut up!
Get rid of your distractions and prepare yourself.
You got a big surprise coming to you. You're not going anywhere.
Welcome, everybody, to the Cult Classic Horror Show. Danny Bonin here with you.
Welcome, y'all. Scotty Bonin here with you.
We are
the Blood Brothers. That was too loud. Sorry.
And
The Rob.
All three of us.
Oh, fresh back together. From his fresh back from his delayed honeymoon. 13-year honeymoon.
Yeah, it was delayed, but it was well worth it.
Hell yeah. Savannah, Georgia, right?
You went to Savannah with Savannah.
Yes.
Yeah.
I put that together too.
She got real annoyed with like radio and everything because, you know, WKPI over here in Savannah. And she's like, I'm really getting sick and tired of hearing my name everywhere.
Yep. Oh, yeah. Because they say it for sure on the radio stations.
Good old.
Sorry.
Go.
She was behind me and scared the shit out of me.
Did she scare you with a drink? Because Shannon just brought me this rum and coke.
No, she brought me batteries for my vaporizer.
Oh, nice.
I can't podcast, bro, unless I'm chucking mad fucking clouds.
She basically brought you batteries for your dildo for your ass because it's like the same thing.
You need batteries for your vibrator. You might say vibrator, not vaporizer, right?
I'm trying to tie in that when you vape, you're gay, and it's not working. I'm sorry.
Oh,
sorry. No, because vaping isn't gay. Vaping is the most masculine thing you can do.
Yeah.
Well, and I got a beard while I do it. So.
While you have a vibrator at the same time and you're vaping, that's masculine right there.
Sorry, I had to take a sip of my rum and coke from a straw.
So what's wrong with that?
You should be drinking a ginger. You should be drinking a Jameson's and ginger, not a rum and coke.
Jameson and ginger.
Oh man, yeah. Jameson's and ginger ale is the best.
Yeah. Mm. Oh, I love that. Why can't you drink rum and coke from a straw?
No, you can. I just.
Is it?
Are you drinking it from a straw?
I just thought it was for a feminine that I'm doing that. No.
Yeah, he looked very gay when he did it. If I made
the drink myself, I wouldn't have a straw in it. But she brought it to me, and there's a baby blue straw in it, so I'm just fucking using it.
You looked like Giovanni Ribisi in A Million Ways to Die in the West when he's sipping the straw and dancing and stuff. Yeah. Mm. And you're like holding the straw and like caressing it.
Are you sure? Is it that movie that he does that in?
Oh, yeah. He does it in that. He does it in another one, too. Like the season.
Yeah, what's the other one?
He plays the same character in it.
Is it Ted?
It's Ted. Yeah.
Ted.
Oh, God.
Oh, yeah. It's so he does it in Ted first.
Yeah. Then
A Million Ways to Die in the West, his character comes back. It's not the same character, but he just does it again.
He should have done it in Bad Batch that we just saw.
Yeah, I know.
Oh, well.
Wow. He was crazy in that, too, though.
But anyways, Hellraiser 3.
Hell on Earth.
Yes. Hell on Earth.
1992.
Yeah. I watched it today. I actually participated and watched the film.
Oh, nice. Good. Team player.
I paid the $3.99 on Amazon. Nice. And
God forbid the hosts of the show watch the damn movie they're talking
about. Well, there's three of us. As long as one of the three of us watches the movie, we could all fill in the blanks.
I'm unaware of how many movies have you not watched that we've done?
You don't really need to worry about what I've done.
What's this percentage?
But you've seen him in the past. That's all that matters.
Yes, I have. It's probably like 60-40.
Oh, man. I mean, holy shit.
Well, I mean, I've seen him in the past. There's a couple that I went back and revisited. Now, like Hellraiser 2, I'll admit no. Then there was one a couple of weeks ago. Oh, Alien Resurrection, no. Mm-hmm. I didn't watch that one at all.
Lord, I will just so you listeners know, I watch every single movie like the day before we record podcast.
Me too.
Just let you know.
I probably could have done without Alien Resurrection.
That's because you're all fancy and you've got all your aliens on Blu-ray. You got a whole fucking box set because you think you're better than me.
Apparently, when we talk about movies and shit, you watch like 28 of them a week. So you might as well just slip in the one we're covering on the podcast.
Yeah.
Sometimes you get on a roll. Like, I will admit today, I watched like all of the Sleepaway Camps for
Jesus Christ.
When do
you watch all these movies?
It was a recommendation, and now they were on there. But back to what I was saying. Well, and then like the weekend that I was supposed to watch Alien Resurrection, I watched an entire season of Parks and Rec instead. It just grabbed me.
Is it basically your?
I'm sorry. I'm only human.
Do you just wake up and watch video from like 8 a.m. to midnight and then go back to sleep and repeat?
Well, I keep odd hours. I mean, now that it's just it was on. I had to watch it.
See, sleep pass you by. Like, okay, I better watch
who
this.
Who in 1 week is like, oh, I watched all the Friday the 13th and the 6 hour fucking Crystal Lake Memories.
Yeah, that was over 2 days. That wasn't even a whole week.
You must have just peed in a bucket next to the couch and like, ate your own feces.
There was breaks. Yeah. I mean, there's breaks in between. I believe we ordered out for meals because I didn't leave the house for 2 straight days.
Wait, did you say eat your own feces?
Yeah.
What?
I ordered out. I didn't eat those. But what I was going to say feces. Before I was interrupted about what I may and may not watch on was that certain movies shouldn't be released in HD. Oh. And this is one of them.
Yeah, it was bad.
Because, like, in high def, you see everything. Mm-hmm. And there are a lot of things that you weren't supposed to see that were supposed to be in the shadows.
I wrote down a few things that I, like, that weren't supposed to be seen.
When she walks into the boiler room club and it's all lit up and you can see everything, you're like, oh, shit, that's terrible.
Yeah.
That's really bad set design. Is that a fucking baby doll hanging from fishing string? Fuck is going on here?
Basically, dude. And the audio, I don't know if you noticed, but it was like the worst audio in a movie ever.
The panda was sitting right next to me. She's completely uninterested in it. And I had the volume.
Oh, you had to babysit the volume the whole time.
Yeah.
Ear burst to hear the dialogue and then down to like 10 for the horror. But
yeah,
I don't know if you guys caught it, but there was more audio dubbing in this.
Oh, like, I think the whole thing was audio dubbed.
Yeah. She does too. She's like, why are they dubbed? I'm like, I don't know. And I started watching it, especially the owner of the club, the big guy or whatever.
Oh, yeah.
He's dubbed the whole way through. It's like, did they pick a Russian? It was incredible.
And it seemed like when you first saw him, he's like the skinny guy and all of a sudden his shirt's off and he's like huge. I'm like, what the fuck?
How did he get so big all of a sudden? I think the whole damn movie was dubbed.
You think they filmed it? They lost they all went in the studio and ADR'd the whole movie.
They had fucking Thornbury running the sound because he didn't have any other work at the time.
Oh, was Bill there?
Yeah.
Was Bill involved? Bill was.
We keep talking about Thornbury.
Dude, I think.
Bill was there running the fucking Tascam in the background.
No, Thornbury was in it. You guys missed him.
Oh, really?
You guys didn't see him?
Where was that?
He's in the very first part. He's the one that sells JP the big.
Is that really him?
Yeah.
No, it's not.
It looks like. Did you see his acting skills? Hey, come over here.
It looks like a mix of Thornbury and Charlton Heston with a lot of makeup on.
Yeah. But his acting skills were like Thornbury.
Yeah, they went to the same academy.
It's how much is this thing worth? It's whatever you think it's worth. Okay.
This isn't reality. When somebody is like, it's worth whatever you think it's worth, you don't grab the whole wad of hundreds out of your leather jacket. You turn your back to him, you pull the money out, and you fan it. You're like, shit, well, okay. You know, I came here with 15. I was going to offer him, 12. All right. And you just give him like, you give him like $8 and mm-hmm. you just see where it goes from there. Cause he was pretty happy to get whatever he handed him.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. It was like $200 bills. All right. Thanks.
Bill Thornbury was recording sound and returned it in. And all it was 8 hours of Reggie being the Yiswahili Yadagis.
Yeah. Yep.
All it was just 8 hours of Bill Thornberry's monologues.
Yeah.
Just like, I remember being born. I remember the first pair of white Nikes I ever got, and when I finally got that leather jacket.
Nah, that was. And you're thinking of the time when S. Dutton ran sound.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah. No. Yeah. We need.
Let's not go there.
Oh man. You want to buy this big fucking sculpture? You know what this represents? This represents capitalism, and this is everything that's wrong with it. Is it worth your soul, young man? Oh, the man, Dutton would have been great.
Of course, he would have been
dubbed because they lost all the audio.
Oh, yeah. Of course.
I must admit, the lady roles in this, the girls are pretty hot. I must say, the girl playing Joey was decent. The reporter lady. What's her name? Terry Farrell. And then her friend that was like JP's girlfriend. Her name is Terry in this. Terry, right?
Yeah, Terry. Yeah.
Terry, the dark-haired girl?
Yeah, Terry.
Okay, yeah.
And then Joey's real name in real life, her name's Terry in real life.
But, I love her reporting skills. She just walks into a bar. I'm looking for a pretty girl. Oh, that's JP's girlfriend. There was no investigating involved any of this movie.
And she was like sitting right there in plain sight.
Yeah, she was just staring her.
She's
down.
Like, well, if you see her.
And they like both like looked at each other, it seemed like. Did you guys notice in the very first part when they're carrying that guy in on like a stretcher and like the chains go in and stuff and the chains like cut her leg and then like the head explodes and then she goes out the door.
And the head's still there.
And then you see the head still there.
I did not notice that.
You didn't notice that? I was barely paying attention, and I saw it.
I was too busy laughing about the nurse that wouldn't let him in, but she really had to shit at the same time.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
She was like, I'm sorry, you can't go in.
And she's... Oh.
And I saw her pinch her butt cheeks together. What kills me about the 80s and 90s is, when are reporters like important people? I just don't get it. Like, I'm a reporter. Oh, it's like, oh, she's not the in. Fucking, she's not the yeah. ATF. She's not even anything important. She's a fucking reporter. Yeah, like, don't cares? Worry.
I'm a reporter. So
when did we bring this up before? What were we talked about when?
Oh, there was some.
Was
other
it like a priest or something? Was that like, I'm a priest? Let me in.
Yeah.
Well, what
the fuck were we talking about?
I'm sure that was an exorcist.
Like, maybe that was Amityville. That was maybe. Play Heretic.
It might have been.
No, it was. Yeah, it was Amityville. Yeah. It basically was Amityville 3 or something, to where he just was like a detective.
He's like walking in all the crime scenes. Yeah,
that's
like,
what it was. Yeah, yeah.
They're like, stop, sir. He's like, I'm a priest. Like, oh, go on ahead. Oh,
no, that was Amityville 2, The Possession, where he murdered everybody he killed Burt Young, damn it.
Yeah, god damn it.
God, dude, that freaking boiler room, though, it was like decked out with like fire, and I totally did recognize that. Like, why would there be fire burning up above a bar?
And
like, everyone would be hot as fuck.
Well, and I'm sorry, throughout this whole thing, are the cops not investigating why someone blew up in the fucking ER?
Well, like, I mean, it looks like it's downtown. It's in New York. This kind of stuff happens all the time. The cops are too busy to deal with it. That's why you need the spunky reporter.
Well,
it's like someone,
there are chains floating in midair. They fucking blow up. There's like 5 witnesses, and the cops don't even care. Like, she's on the case, and that's it. I'm like, where are the police at? What the fuck's going on here?
And she's like, I had to get to the bottom of this. Why? What happened to that boy?
Like what?
Why aren't the police?
Yeah, what did the police claim happen? Were they like,
I'm here to tell this story. I'm here to speak for those without voices.
The cops showed up and were like, oh, open, close, spontaneous combustion case here. We're out.
Yeah, that's definitely a 1081, isn't it, Phil? Yeah, for sure. Let's just go back to whatever we're doing.
Yeah. God,
nurse is in the corner, freaking holding in a turtle head.
Yeah, she's just she just drops flat to the ground and just lets it out there.
Yeah,
she's like, cliffhanger just hanging there.
Yep. She's got fucking Stallone hanging out of her ass.
Stallone hanging right out of her ass.
How did he even know about this statue? Like, I don't understand. It just opens with him buying it.
Exactly.
All these Hellraiser movies, which is okay. I'm not faulting too much, but they open up with just idiots. Like, I want to buy this puzzle box that kills people.
I don't know.
I want to buy this giant floating death statue.
I don't think he had any idea what the
hell it was. And, like, the second one ends with, like, the big, like, rod, like, wooden rod with his face in it. Now we got, like, a statue with his face in it. I don't know.
I'm still confused about everything.
I think this, I don't know, I might have liked this. Did you guys like this one better than the second one, or what do you think?
I like this one better than the second one because you got to learn about Elliot, and they had.
I think so too.
I like this one better because and I know maybe we'll get flack for saying that because everyone and their mom's commenting on our page that the second one's their favorite one ever.
I mean, the second one's entertaining. I think
I'm not going to diss it too much because I think I have to watch the second one again. But after first watching. I just have no fucking idea what the hell happened or what was going on.
Yelling at me about not watching movies. Apparently you didn't.
I watched it. You didn't even watch it. You freely admitted.
I've seen it before. I know what happens. It's a pretty easy. I just don't understand how you don't get it. I mean,
you understand how I don't get how there's like a fucking construction paper cone in the sky with like blotted ink water running out of it.
It's art, Danny. I mean, it's some people get it, some people don't.
What is this triangular box? I still don't
know. We saw it in this one too.
Yeah, and I still don't know what the fuck it is.
If I have to explain it to you, then it's going to take away from you finding out what it is when you find out.
It's the cube shaped box.
I'm going to wake up in the middle of the night and go, "That's what it is."
Yeah.
It's like when you figure out Phantasm. As soon as you figure out what Phantasm is, then
no one's figured out Phantasm.
Yeah.
I figured out Phantasm.
No.
We have a brief idea of what Phantasm
is. It's a dream within a dream within a dream.
Yeah.
It's a dream within a dream. It's like Inception times 8.
Yeah.
Well, I've never seen Inception. So
yeah, it's because you're stupid.
No, it's because I don't like Leonardo DiCaprio.
He's the best.
But he's totally offset by Tom Hardy. And,
I don't know who Tom Hardy is either.
Oh my god!
You know who Tom Hardy is.
He knows who Tom Hardy is. Yeah. He just likes to say he doesn't know who Tom Hardy is.
I just have to say it every episode.
I don't know who Tom Hardy is.
There's tons of other good people.
Joseph Gordon-Levitt is in it.
There has to be other good people.
Gordon-Levitt is.
Tom Hardy takes the cake. He's in it. That's all you need to know.
Whenever my schedule allows, in between watching all the Friday the 13th again, Sleepaway Camp, or I Spit on Your Grave, or any other 80s horror movies, I'll try to squeeze Inception.
I had Cillian Murphy's in it.
Michael Caine's in it.
Cillian Murphy's.
Ellen Page.
I like Cillian Murphy. I like Cillian.
Did you watch Sunshine yet, Rob? Did you watch it?
Tom Berenger's in Inception.
Okay.
I like Berenger.
He's in Inception too.
The substitute is awesome.
I did have a dream about DiCaprio the other night. It was really weird. I was at some like acting camp where you got like 10 minutes of one-on-one time with DiCaprio. And I went in and for some reason it was a young DiCaprio. And like
Romeo and Juliet DiCaprio?
Not as young as Titanic, because Romeo and Juliet was after Titanic, right?
I think so. Did he still have the floppy hair?
Yeah.
Okay. So I got you.
Floppy hair. And he was like talking about acting and trying to say you have to have the character's breath. Like, how would this character's breath smell? And I was like, I don't know, like this. Well, say that line and let me smell your breath and see if you have done it right.
The fuck kind of dreams are you having, sir? I have
no fucking idea. That was it, though.
When Leonardo DiCaprio asks you to smell your breath, there's something, like, I don't know what's going on up there in Colorado, but there's something seriously going. Because we all know DiCaprio's breath smells like dick. So.
You're talking about Kevin Costner, right? Yeah.
And then, shut your mouth.
During all this, Thornberry's in the corner watching and jerking it.
Oh, of course he was.
Of course he was. But Thornberry does that when he's like at Dunkin' Donuts. That's just what Thornberry does.
Oh yeah, yeah. He goes there every single morning.
He does that while watching bums eat glazed donuts. Actually, it's the bums eating the Boston cream pie that gets him off.
he buys it for them. He's like, "Can I watch you eat it?"
I wonder if he'll make us call him Mr. Thornberry. I wonder if we could call him Bill, or if he wants to be called William now.
We're still going to interview him, right?
I don't think we can.
Didn't Mace get us an interview with him?
Even if Mace gets the interview locked in, I just don't think we can go through with it.
Dude, well, he probably won't listen to any of this.
Oh, he's going to listen to all of this.
He's like,
he's going to be so pumped. He might look, Bill, or look, William. One-on-one here, man. It's all jokes. I mean, you know, you do what you do, and that's awesome.
We respect you for it, damn it.
We just really want you to all the jokes that we make. We just need you to nod yes or no if they're true. Mm-hmm. I just want to know if do you still have that iRock Camaro you drive around high schools? I mean,
this would be an audio interview, so we will have no idea if he's nodding.
No, we got a video Skype, but that'll be for Patreon. By the way, y'all need to join our Patreon for the audio, for the video Skype.
Oh, I did want to mention the Patreon starting, sure. If I can remember, starting next episode, we're recording all our pre-show conversations and putting them in Patreon for you guys who are patrons.
Because we usually have like a 15-minute little like talking before the episode.
Or more.
Yeah.
Yeah, if you think we're chaotic and just disgusting right now, you should hear.
For instance, if I had recorded this tonight's pre-show, some of the topics were Colin Farrell's penis,
yep. or lack thereof.
We also talked about sushi salad and what else? What else?
Nicole Kidman's nose.
We didn't talk about Nicole Kidman.
Not really. I said a little bit.
I mean, she was a highly talked about getting day drunk in Savannah.
Yeah, that's right.
Yep.
We covered a lot. I mean, we talked about a lot.
So starting next week, I don't know what level we'll put that at in the Patreon. Probably just like the $1 or $5 level.
Yeah.
You get that shit. So
and you get shirts and stickers.
Yeah, shirts, stickers. Tell you the truth, we just don't have anyone there now because we aren't doing shit besides giving shirts and stickers. But now there will be weekly pre-show content uploaded.
Yeah, hell yeah.
So
That's step one.
We'll be adding
some good shit.
We're also wanting to do a bonus episode probably per month of like video of commentary on a movie or something.
Yeah.
So we'll see. Anyways.
We'll keep you guys posted on it.
I know what I want to talk about next. I have a list of some ridiculous things here.
Hellraiser 3. Yes.
Yeah. What were we talking about? Hellraiser 3 starring Bill Thornberry.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
As it sounds.
Sorry. We just got to fucking stop talking.
Yeah.
About everyone who's listening is probably like, fucking Bill Thornberry again. God damn it.
You know what's funny? We're probably boosting his ass up because I wonder how many people are Googling who the fuck is Bill Thornberry.
Oh, yeah, here have to be
guaranteed.
I mean, I'm sure his agent is like, oh, let's check like Google Analytics. Holy shit.
Yeah, what the hell?
He's like,
Bill, you got to come back, man. They're clamoring for you, Bill.
Dude, tons of fans.
Your fucking star meter on IMDb is just through the roof right now.
I know your last three checks to me bounced, but look.
Let's get you back over here. Come on. That's so
these
funny.
Young kids with their iTablets and their pod cases, they're talking about you all over the interwebs, Bill.
And then anyone who's started listening to our show and hasn't listened to the Phantasm series is like, what the fuck are they talking about? The fuck is Bill Thornberry? And they look him up and they're like, why don't fucking get any of it still?
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Well, they probably think he's a mystery because his ass doesn't even have a picture on. He doesn't even have a Wikipedia page.
No.
He has a Facebook, though.
I'm sorry to all the fans who are just tuning in. Just go back and start from the Phantasm series.
Bill Thornberry was in Phantasm. That's the only thing he's ever done. And he played Jody.
We can't explain everything right now. Just listen to it. Since the Phantasm episodes.
And find him on Facebook, friend him, and send him a message. And just tell him that Cult Classic Horror sent you.
Yes.
Yes.
Say CCH sent you. Maybe don't, because then he'll listen to everything.
And then
I think we should. I think you should. And then if you screenshot it, then you know you can use that in replacement of a meme. Mm-hmm. I just want Bill Thornberry to be inundated.
Yes.
With Cult Classic Horror fan mail.
Sweet.
Hopefully his dial-up internet works and he's good to go.
Hopefully he's got a fresh AOL disc in the mail.
his Nokia flip phone's going to be blowing up. How do I even check this goddamn email?
The hell. All right, let's get to Hellraiser 3.
Oh, man. He's got a fucking Windows 95 on his.
Yep. Windows 90. He has the big ass monitor that takes up like his whole room. God. Fuck.
Holy shit. Oh, anyways.
So, what did you guys think of like that 90s, 80s band in the boiler room?
Freaking Armored Saint.
Yeah.
They were good.
They were killing it.
They were Armored Saint. I actually looked them up. They've been around for a while.
That's a real band? Going. Is it a real band?
Yeah.
Wow.
That's performed crazy. By Armored Saint, performing the song Hanging Judge. So that's actually one of their songs, too.
But the title song that, was performed
they by Motorhead. They thought they were going to make it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
After this playing. Movie, they were like, holy shit, man, we're going to be like the Ramones on Pet Cemetery.
Yeah, we were in Hellraiser 3.
But there was a Motorhead did a specific Hellraiser song for this movie at the end.
Oh, nice. The credits.
I did hear that. Yeah, that was great.
Yeah, it wasn't that great. It was awesome. That's Ben Stein.
Did you guys notice there was just that boiler room had like everything in it? There was like a random nice restaurant at the end of everything.
Did you notice that the reporter went in and she like asks, what's his name again? It's like P.T.
J.P.?
J.P.
J.P.
J.P. what? What was his? I wanted to say like J.P. Morgan, but it's not obviously.
Monroe?
Monroe, yeah.
J.P. Monroe.
Oh,
Monroe,
I thought it was. I was thinking J.P. Morgan the whole time.
So she goes in and asks him a question. God, why didn't I write this fucking down? She like asks him a question, and then he instead of answering it, I don't know, he says something, and then she like, it's like does a burn on him, you know, and walks away. I'm like, she didn't get her question answered.
Oh, yeah. She said,
what the fuck was it?
It was,
Oh, yeah. He's like, you want to type. He's like, you want to sit on, you want to come over here or something? And first she asked him a question. She's like, have you seen this girl? Blah, blah, blah. And, he's like, well, do you want to join us? And she was like, I'm not your type. I'm out of grade school. And then she like turned and like walked away like burn. But she probably got like 10 feet away. I was like, oh fuck. I asked him a question and I didn't wait for the answer.
Oops. I forgot. Damn it.
Do you own this club? Yeah. And everything in it.
Yeah.
Oh God. You're just filthy. Aren't you? It's like, but no, she is the shittiest reporter of all time.
I want to know the backstory on P.T. Barnum here. Like what? How the fuck does he have? Yeah, whatever. I have J.P. Morgan, J.P.
Well,
Freeman.
Well, he killed his parents.
Yeah, he did. And how do we only found out he killed his parents just because Pinhead said so.
Well, and who, like, did he have this club before? Was his parents?
No, I think he killed his parents for, like, the insurance money.
Uh-huh. Well, like, how, were his parents wealthy? Or like,
well, I mean, insurance money's good money. I mean, you got, maybe like, if they were both insured for, like, $1 million each. I mean, I don't know. Not that I've ever thought of it or anything. Or. Mm-hmm.
So J.P. Morgan Freeman kills his parents.
Yes.
And
opens up the club
and attaches like includes everything in it. It's this multiplex of
five-star
restaurant club
band playing.
And
well, he's a genius. He's a genius businessman.
Yeah,
I mean,
sure.
You have to have something for everybody.
There was a strip club with like an average dude dancing. Did you see the average dude dancing on the?
There was an average guy dancing.
It was the same guy in both scenes. He just had overalls on in the second one. I think it was. I'm not going there. I'm sorry.
No, don't.
He didn't have a leather jacket and a Coors Light. That wasn't Thornberry.
He only made the appearance in the first scene. Could have been Reg. Yeah, yeah.
It could. Well, no. Reg is in the crowd. Like nervously groping women. that's what Reg is doing. He's just
testing
in the crowd.
The waters.
Like, yeah, just like, oops, I kind of stumble. No, she's not into it. Oops, I kind of, oh, okay, she didn't push me away too hard, you know. Hey, what's going on, girl? You ever had sex with pants on? Because that's how I do it.
You ever had sex through the zipper?
Yeah. Have you ever had rough, vicious, bloody sex through a zipper of some dungarees?
Dry humping.
Dungarees. Those aren't dungarees, dude. Those are Wranglers.
Whatever. Those things were rough.
Those were Walmart Wranglers.
Oh my God. That was so freaking funny.
Dungarees. Dunkaroos?
Dunkaroos.
Remember
Dunkaroos?
I love Dunkaroos. I wish
they could. You guys remember Dunkaroos?
Oh, yeah, the little cookies.
Like the vanilla frosting and graham crackers.
Oh, so good. Oh, Dunkaroos. Man,
they were the best.
Do they still make Dunkaroos?
I don't think so.
They definitely don't. But really, all it is if you buy cake frosting and graham crackers and dip the graham crackers
in cake. But who wants to do that?
I do it all the time.
Oh, man. So good.
Graham crackers and cake frosting is a shit.
Well, I mean, yeah, but you gotta buy graham crackers and the cake frosting. Like, you kind of want them together. It's kind of like Go-Gurt.
Yeah, but Dunkaroos, you needed about 10 packs of those to satisfy.
That was like
your
a kid snack. True. Like that's
you got
like
one in your lunch and you ate it, and it was just a tease. You're like, fuck me. You're like, fuck you.
You
need
like 10 more of them. Yeah,
I need at least 5 more of these fucking packets.
I'll still kill Capri Suns whenever we get Capri Suns for the kids.
Yeah,
those are mine.
They're all right.
Dude, I love Capri Suns.
You know, looking back when you were a kid, they never put enough of anything in any of those fucking snacks. There's never enough frosting in Dunkaroos. There's never enough fucking cheese in the cheese spread crackers.
It's a tease. Like, what are you supposed to put, like, cheese on the corner of the cracker? Because if you put it on the whole cracker, you get like 2 crackers worth of cheese.
And now as adults, when you go to the fucking baseball game, they put like 2 dollops of nacho cheese in with your bag of tortilla chips.
Yeah, that is a ripoff. I'd rather just pay for it. I'll give you extra money just to give me more cheese.
Yeah. It's ridiculous.
You need to go to like the good places where they do like the homemade nacho cheese and stuff. They have one of those at Coors Field. You can't buy the shitty concession nachos.
It's just wasteful because in the end you're just wasting cheese and crackers because I'm not eating just plain fucking tortilla chips.
Yeah.
Throwing the shits away.
I'll eat it if I have a drink.
That's not the same.
And you know what? They should give you triple cheese in those. What are those things? What are those fucking cheese and cracker things called?
They're like
Kraft. I don't know what they're called. I know
Kraft
what they're
called.
Kraft cheese and crackers.
They should give you like half a cracker, and the other side should be filled with cheese. Because I'll dip the cracker, and then I'll just eat the cheese with that little rectangular plastic thing.
Little red rectangular plastic.
I'll eat the whole. I'll just straight eat the cheese.
I just dig my finger.
I don't know what's
in
there,
shit.
But it's like when they came out with Reese's peanut butter in like the jars.
I didn't even know they did that.
Oh, they do. You can just go get Reese's peanut butter.
Yep.
Just jar Reese's fucking, peanut butter. Tastes like the shit that's inside Reese's.
It's close. It's close. But, I mean, it's not quite the same. But, I mean, yeah, I just sit there. I get to sit with a spoon.
Really?
It's like I'm not making a peanut butter and jelly sandwich out of Reese's peanut butter. I'm just getting the shit just to eat myself into
just
a stroke.
Straight up.
Wow.
That's probably
I don't know what they put in this shit. That the cheese and crackers, I don't think there's an ounce of anything having to do with cheese in that.
Breadsticks too. Like the little breadstick ones you can just dip in like the the little stick crackers.
Yeah, those were fancy though. Yeah. I just want crackers. I don't want fancy breadsticks.
Holy, is it already that time?
Oh my goodness, what is
Son
that
of
noise?
A bitch.
Oh, no, it scared the shit out of Steve.
God, I shit myself.
That means it's time for the
whore halftime.
Oh my God, I actually got to pull up the page real quick because I didn't even look at shit.
Dun, 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 dun.
You can look at the shit here, my underpants. Ooh, you switched it up a little bit at the end there.
Well, it's because I keep getting accused of copying Rocky, which I am not.
Straight up copy Rocky every single time.
I'm not copying Rocky. It's my own melody.
Well, we'll see. I want you to get it professionally done by like a house band, and then we'll decide.
You trying to say I'm not a professional?
There's questionable.
Questionable professional.
All right,
who is our winner?
Now. I'm looking at
we got a good
right
mattress
now.
One. I see the mattress, the Hellraiser mattress.
Yeah, that was David Mace.
David Caulfield really killed it with a couple.
Those were on Twitter too. Oh God, I know he did. He did this Thompson's one, and I almost just have to go with that. But
that is so good. Shh, we're the Thompsons.
There are a few other good ones too, though. The period.
Yeah, he did a real man loves B.J. Alvarez.
Yeah, I love B.J.'s one.
A real man loves his woman all month long. That is so good.
But someone else did one too. Let me see if I can find it. It was Sarah Dugan had a good one. Oh, she won last year. But there was one on Twitter last week. There's one on Twitter with her. Let me look at it real quick.
I don't have the tweets. I got
the tweets right here.
Oh, Stephen Reed, I like it, man. You did a Dr. Loomis shenanigans. Yeah, life's more fun when you're up to something. That was great.
Okay, where the fuck was it? Oh yeah, it's Joshua McMillan.
Here it is. Yeah, which
I think won already.
Well, yes, it is that time of the month again. Yeah,
this is some good one.
And she's drinking the Chardonnay, the glass of Chardonnay, or the glass of wine.
Justin Button has a good one. Netflix and Suffering. That one's older though. Okay, I'm sorry. I gotta give it. Well, fuck. But he's won too.
Josh McMillan won, right? Did he?
Yeah, but so has Hold on, let me go back here.
Well, I mean, we got for the running. We got B.J. Alvarez for A Real Man Loves His Woman All Month Long.
And Cofield's won though too. Damn it, David.
But we do say your Twitter. Twitter usually wins. Best.
Yeah, but he's won. You won already, man. But your shit's. I love the We're the Thompsons one. That one has a special place in my heart.
Yeah, because you listen. We're the Thompsons. You're participating. We like that.
They're right across the street.
But because I know he has never won, we're going to give it to B.J. Alvarez. Horror, Freak of the Week, Real Man Loves His Woman.
B.J. Hell yeah, no matter if they're bloody or not.
Cofield's has a special place in my heart.
Got the golf clap.
But
got
BJ,
the golf clap.
Yeah, yep. You get the golf clap. BJ is the horror freak of the week.
Congratulations, so. BJ. But big shout out to David. damn it.
I love that one.
Big shout out to Joshua Thompsons McMillan, so too.
The Thompsons.
Yeah.
Okay.
If only your neighbors knew. What was going on?
What's that, a podcast you have going on over there?
It's like nighttime right now because we're recording this literally right before we launch it.
It's 11:03 p.m.
I'm afraid I'm going to look over Scotty's shoulder and she's going to be like, her face is going to be right in the window.
Yeah.
Right
there. Dude, that'd be fucking freaky.
What y'all doing in there? You know, we used to live up in Lyons before the flood came in. And
great flood.
I got some hand towels for you.
I baked you some cookies and, we're right over here. We're the Thompsons.
Dude, there's this old lady that freaking reminded me of her. I went to New Mexico last night. We stayed at a Quality Inn, and this old lady was like, hey, if there's anything you need, just let me know.
We're the Thompsons.
She could have said that, dude. She reminded me of the lady across the street. She seriously did. She was like softly spoken, but talked forever. You're like, okay, I'm going up to the room now. So it's freaking funny as hell.
All right, well, it's a new week. We need a new horror freak of the week.
Yes.
And just so you know, we're doing one of these weird things again where we're going to record next week's episode, like tomorrow or the next day. So we won't announce the winner next week. We'll announce two winners in 2 weeks.
Yes.
If that makes sense.
We'll be up in the mountains.
Yeah, we're going to be like in the mountains.
Next Wednesday.
I thought you were going to Orlando.
No, we're going to Orlando in October.
Oh, well.
Kidding me?
Shit, I didn't know.
Yeah. For Horror Nights. If anyone out there is going to Halloween Horror Nights in October at Universal between... God, when are we going? The second week of October.
Yeah. First weekend or second weekend?
7th through the whatever that week, 14th.
Yeah.
Hit us up. Let's grab a drink.
Oh, man. I'm gonna have to go down there.
You should meet us down there, and anyone of the fans should meet us down there, and we'll get... Rob, you can have a mule. We don't all drink the same thing. I'll have my rum and coke. You can have your mule.
I'll have a beer.
And there you go.
I'll drink anything and everything. Yes.
Okay, so y'all are going down there Saturday the 7th through the 14th.
Yeah, I think it's Friday.
The second weekend or the first weekend?
Friday is the 7th.
Yeah, it's the second weekend. No,
Friday's the 6th.
Oh. Maybe it's the 6th then. I think it's the 6th.
Well, whatever. I'll be down there. I got to come down there. It's going to be awesome.
We'll make sure you know the exact dates once we get off
here. We haven't got our tickets yet. We'll have to coordinate that. Jesus
Christ. I'm going to have to drive because they're not going to let me bring all my vape gear on the plane. We already know what happens when you try to fly out of Tallahassee. It'll probably cost me 20 grand.
Oh, yeah. God.
This horror halftime has gone on way too long. So get your memes for Hellraiser 3 or 4. God, what the fuck are we
Hellraiser on? 3. Hell on Earth.
Yeah, okay, yeah, Hellraiser 3, Hell on Earth. And the winner from this week and next week will be announced in 2 weeks.
Awesome.
That concludes the horror halftime. All right. I'm only like three deep in my list here.
Yeah, let's get back into this.
What's your fault for bringing a list? This format is not contingent with lists and or facts.
Is it just me, or in all of these movies, 1, 2, and now 3, they just need, everyone has like an immense amount of sweat on them whenever they're having sex or anything like that.
Well, that's how you know you're doing it right.
Like, literally, you know, JP Freeman Morgan is like,
well, he was going for it. He had his arms stretched out.
Dude, yeah, he was sex no hands, man.
Oh, and he was like, smoking a cigarette at the same time. Oh, he had a cigarette amazing.
All times of this whole, the whole time.
He reminded me of like the little kids you see taking a piss in the urinal with their pants all the way down in their hands, like behind their head.
Yeah. Look, mom, no hands.
I still do it. Ass hanging out and everything.
I've seen for sure.
Grown men piss in the urinal without their hands, and I have no idea. Like, how do you just?
I see him like texting while they're peeing.
How do you
like,
have that much? Fuck? How do you have that much trust?
With both hands
in your Don Johnson. Like, how do you have that much trust? I just can't. I gotta keep a hand on it.
You gotta get like the exhausted pee to where like both arms are folded up and your head's rested on them, leaning up against the cool tile, just peeing. Mm-hmm. Just like, I don't even have time, man. I can't even hold it. I'm done. I'm frustrated.
I gotta always have a hand on it. I can't just.
You gotta have a firm grasp on what's good. Maybe you're just controlling.
It doesn't have to be firm. It can be a pointer and pointer finger thumb grip.
Yeah.
Pointer finger thumb grip. That's all I need. And sometimes all you need is just the thumb on top to keep it from popping up. Just, you know, to help hold that aim down there. I just don't know how people just.
You need at least have something. Yeah. I can't. It'd go decently in the toilet, but I'd probably pee on the side.
The only time you can do no hands is if you're sitting to pee because you're pooping and you just tuck it under the toilet seat.
Of course.
No, you can't pee when you poop.
What?
No, I poop and then I stand up to pee, or I stand up to pee.
What the fuck are you talking about? Dude, if you're pushing to poop,
do you hold your piss while you're pushing your poop out?
Or like vice versa. I just there's something wrong about doing it both. Doing two things at once like that, it's not right.
The dumbest thing I've ever heard.
You have to pee when you're pooping.
No, you sit down, and depending on the situation, you tuck it just right up underneath the toilet seat to hold it down for you.
Exactly. You leave your penis above the toilet seat?
You don't have to do that every time. But. Dude, how do you
it's down there already. It's just I don't do both.
I don't understand how you can let poop out when you have
to pee. Usually I pee first. I just get that over with.
So you stand up and pee, flush, and then sit down and poop.
Well, sometimes I don't flush because you don't want to waste water.
Well, then you're splashing piss all over your ass.
What's the piss?
Well, I mean, I'm not splashing. I mean, it's
you
it's,
don't know that. You don't know if you're gonna have a fucking A bomb come out of your
like
ass,
big ass nuggets, or like
toilet bowl,
like a machine gun into the toilet.
You never mean to splash your ass, but if you've pissed in there and you do it, you're like, oh fuck, now I gotta wipe the whole circumference of my ass.
Well, we have already gone over my wiping. Apparently, that's not up to par either because I do it while I sit.
Yeah, that's not good.
Yeah. Apparently, a lot of people do that.
Do you look at it when you're done wiping?
No, I don't look at it.
How do you know it's clean?
How do you know it's clean?
How do you know it's clean?
How do you know it's all gone? Yeah.
You just know. You can just feel it becomes less slippery.
I bet. Okay, here's the test. Reach into your pants right now and like just sort of just lightly rub around your asshole and smell your finger.
Well, I'm not doing that on the podcast. That's just gross.
So wait, I just can't even get over this. What if you have to like crap really bad, but you have to, God forbid, pee before you crap, and you're peeing, and then all of a sudden you just shart the shit out of yourself.
Yeah,
while you're standing.
Well, I mean, that's all about it's all about control.
Pop quiz, hot shot.
No, you can't control that.
What if you really have to shit?
You can't.
And God forbid you have to pee first, and then you shart all over your pants. Pop quiz, hot shot.
I've never done that before. It's just this. It's never come up.
Or vice versa. What if you have to like poop really bad, then you go, then also you have to pee really bad, but then you wait till you're done pooping, and then you pee afterwards?
Yeah.
How do you know it's clean if you don't look? Do you just like gauge the resistance on the toilet paper when you're wiping?
You could gauge it when it's done.
I gotta look.
You gotta look. Okay, another question. If it's like your fourth shit of the day, or if it's like a real nasty one, you have to end it with like a flushable wet wipe.
I don't do the wet wipes yet. I still need to do it. You
have to end it with a flushable wet wipe.
I need to get me some of those.
I don't do wet wipes.
I don't either. I need to get myself some of those.
I had a bad experience with wet wipes, and I don't mess with them.
Sometimes they burn, about that. Burn your ass a little bit.
Well, no, I mean, I was out working in the field surveying, and
are you an explorer?
I had to go take a shit.
Are you an explorer? Were you?
Well, I mean, I used to be a land surveyor, kind of like an explorer, and I had to take a shit, and one of the guys thought it was really funny, and they threw me. They said, "Oh, you know, we don't have any toilet paper." They threw me what I thought was a wet wipe. It was an alcohol pad out of the first aid kit.
Ooh, that's got to burn.
That's got to burn. Yeah, there was some chafing. It was pretty bad. So I just don't trust them. Even the ones that smell like lavender, I don't trust.
Yeah. Then your butt's all, you know, like water, like it's just like clammy and watery and moist. It still cleans it though. Especially if you have raw ass. Anyways, so this film was the first one not to be filmed in the UK. First filmed outside of the United Kingdom. And the first to be released under Miramax and under Dimension Films.
And in the UK, they have bidets to really clean your ass, God. And you won't even use a wet wipe. Sorry, I digress.
No, I mean, I just don't do wet wipes.
And look at it. How do you not look at it?
I mean, you just don't. I mean, it's just, this like, just,
you know,
just
you're, don't, I have you, don't to. Need to, you know, you're you perfectly just, set when there's no poop and there's like a tiny speckle of blood.
That's how you get an infection.
Oh, God, I hate
once you start bleeding down there, that's how you get an infection.
Tiny little, like, speckle.
I'm just joking about that
little,
one. Tiny
little thing of blood on the TP. That's when you're buying the wrong toilet paper.
Okay, now we can move on. So, were we done talking about the ridiculous amount of sweat that's all over everybody whenever they kiss, even? There's just like sweat everywhere. Yeah,
there's always a lot of sweat, a lot of cigarettes. That was the 90s, man.
And he's still sweating.
80s and 90s.
They finished doing it, and he figures out, like, you know, it sucks her skin off and eats her up, the statue. And then it's like 10 minutes later, he's talking to him, but he's still covered in dripping sweat.
Well, he's scared of Pinhead.
I don't know.
Freaked out.
Maybe there's like an issue with the HVAC system.
Think back to Hellraiser, the first Hellraiser, with the Frank and what's that ugly girl's name scene?
Well, I don't know any ugly girl.
Claire Higgins.
Frank and Claire scene.
Julia.
They're both like sweating. Julia. They're both sweating their asses off the whole time. It makes me. It just.
Well, they're having sex.
Yeah, but
hardcore sex.
Every time I have. Do you not sweat during lovemaking, Danny?
Maybe once every, if it's hot, and I don't know, not that much. No.
You're doing it wrong if you're not sweating.
You got to be.
First of all, I just don't sweat that much in general.
It's like negative 30 in Colorado.
I'm not like you, Rob, where you get off the couch to go take a piss and you got like armpit stains in your shirt.
Oh, yeah. No, if I peel an orange, I'm sweating. I mean, that's just how it is.
Peel a banana, peel an orange, throwing sweat. God.
What the fuck did you do? Did you do like 100 jumping jacks? No, I'm fucking peeled a banana. Shit just happens.
So, and obviously we learned that blood brings back like Pinhead. So we found out that the rat biting his hand and the blood splashing against the statue brought it like to life.
Yeah, I guess started the events in motion. And that was a ton of blood for just a little bit of his hand.
Yeah, that rat fucking was on his hand. Yeah. And then that obviously brought Pinhead back, and I don't get, like, he lures Terry back in and, you know, to feed her to the statue now, and I kind of missed it, like, she punches him with the brass knuckles and then he gets knocked out, then Pinhead lures her back in, and does he, like, why does he take JP and not her?
Well, he just needed somebody.
Yeah,
he didn't care who he got. This movie was like written for Doug Bradley's voice. They're like, man, it turns out he's got a pretty awesome voice. Like, let's give him more every lines. Kind of monologue known to man. Like, he has speech after speech, and it's good. I mean, they're not as good as Brad Dourif's speech in what was it? Exorcist 3. Yeah. That was an awesome
story. Or Charles S. Dutton's speeches.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah all of them. All of Dutton's speeches combined.
And Donald Pleasance's, yeah.
Yeah, well, Donald, was he as good? I think no, Dutton Cousins hasn't
didn't have any good speeches.
There were some decent ones that he went on.
They were always interrupted by.
Pouch boy.
No, but yeah,
that is how Bill Thornberry got his start in Hollywood. That's what it is. Bill Thornberry was the pouch boy. We've connected our two most famous inside jokes. But
wasn't Phantasms being filmed when some of the Friday the 13th were?
Well, maybe like the first one.
Yeah, he still could. Yeah, but
he was switching in and out. I mean, Thornberry's got talent. You know, he's out there working. He's a working man.
Yeah. Pouch boy ended up.
No, but you're right. He does. Doug Bradley has that voice, and we obviously saw him more as his human self in this too. When the flashbacks to like the war time,
isn't his human self like sort of really a letdown? After you see him as Pinhead,
it's all right.
You see him in.
Yeah, you like Pinhead better.
It's like, what is this?
Is Pinhead
skinny,
voice.
Balding?
Yeah, he's very tiny. He's he's a very torpy little British man.
Small hands.
I don't know why they thought of having him. Yeah, I just know how they chose him in the first place.
Yeah.
But now with all these monologues, he's glad he didn't choose the mover role back in the first one.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sure.
I was actually reading this. This is the first film in the Hellraiser franchise to refer to Doug Bradley's character as Pinhead within the movie. So they call him Pinhead, periodically through the movie, they call him Pinhead. It's the first time they actually stuck with that, with the word, you know.
I'm thinking that blonde girl that Morgan Freeman banged in the bed.
Yeah.
I'm thinking.
The one that got her skin ripped off?
Yeah, yeah. I'm thinking she was a porn actress they hired and paid cheap to do this because her acting was fucking horrible.
I mean, you know, it's...
Yeah, I mean, it was...
No, it was pretty bad.
Yeah, it was... Yeah. But
I mean, her acting was that of a porn star probably like in the casting.
Yeah.
Like, we need like the stupidest sounding person that we can find. Like, oh my God, this stuff... God, you got great taste, right? Yeah. Yeah. Oh, you gave me a rose. Oh, you dick.
Oh, bastard.
You asshole. And then she kept backing up towards the statue.
And then her final thing was way over the top. I forgot. She was like,
And then Doug Bradley.
He had a great scream. Yeah.
We're the Thompsons.
Shh.
Where the Thompsons?
I don't remember her saying that one.
that's what Doug Bradley said to her before he skinned her alive.
Yeah.
Shh. Where are the Thompsons?
He went, ah, ha, ha, ha. Where are the Thompsons?
He has like this.
I just wanted to say that.
Booming laugh. This is great.
Did you guys notice all the KY jelly coming out of the statue, basically?
Yeah, that was unnecessary.
I don't know what that was all about.
It was thick and gelatinous. Like, I mean, it was like made very sick flopping noises when it hit the ground.
I think they brought in Mama on this.
Was Mother there?
It was Mama from Alien.
From Alien, yeah. KY guy.
Mama.
You guys need some lube.
This statue needs more KY jelly.
He was there for sure.
I'm so jelly of this.
Oh my God,
statue.
Is that Bill Thornberry? I loved his work in Halloween.
He's the best Halloween pouch boy ever. Mama had a hand in this. She was on that.
Oh my God.
For those of you that didn't know, the KY helper for Alien's name was Mama, and it was a guy.
The KY applicator.
KY applicator for Alien, his name was Mama, and he was very flamboyant.
And very good. Supposedly,
yes,
very good at lubing up
aliens. The alien, the tall, skinny guy.
Did you guys notice that JP says the come to daddy line in this?
So oh, did he?
Yeah, when Terry like gets away,
there was a lot of daddies like, in this movie. Like she was having a nightmare. Well, it was a Vietnam War crazy nightmare. She was having a nightmare.
Yeah, that was Frank's line.
And she was like, "Where's my daddy? My daddy's still alive." It's like you're 35.
Yeah, you don't have a daddy.
Did you notice like the flashback?
Unless he's a black pimp.
The flat.
What? No, I mean, her daddy.
I just, that's just, it's just rude. I mean,
Black Pimp.
Well, I don't know. We're in the, okay.
Labeling daddy, Pimp.
Black like, Pimp. I don't even get it.
I don't know. I just picture a hooker saying, hey, daddy. And him going, get out
yeah.
there, bitch.
Okay. Yeah. Like daddy to the black guy. I got it.
I don't know.
Was this part of the Leonardo DiCaprio dream?
Cause
yeah. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Cause you only call
something else we covered. That we just
oh my God.
It was like a 10-part dream. DiCaprio was only part of it. I don't even remember the fucked up shit that also happened. I can't even remember.
I'm not going into it because that'll be stuff we'll save for the page. Yeah,
let's just
Danny's dreams about Leonardo DiCaprio.
Let's not get into that.
Did anyone else notice the smoking deal on that TV? $180.
No, that wasn't. I mean, that was back then.
$180. That's expensive.
That? $180 on that sweet tube TV.
Oh yeah, no,
that thing had two dials on it and a push knob.
Yeah, they were in her apartment, so fancy with the wallpaper from floor to ceiling. This movie was very 80s, 90s. I appreciated some parts of it, but other parts, especially in high def, I was like, oh, fuck.
You know that TV had the push pull to turn it on and off, and also acted as the volume knob.
Oh yeah.
And then, you know, like day two of owning it, the knob would break, would slide off, and then you would just use the spindle to push and pull and turn it up and down.
And then the best part was about this was one of the Cenobites as the DJ was CDs.
Oh yeah, yep. I was just gonna say that. Yeah, he threw CDs like cut people's faces off.
This whole movie was sponsored by Compact.
Because like 90s CDs coming out,
everybody was smoking cigarettes. Everybody smoked. Even people that didn't smoke smoked in this movie.
Everyone had a cigarette. Like the guy wakes up, he pops a cigarette in his mouth before he says anything.
When they were towards the end in that pit gravel area, there was a box in the background with a brand name on it. I forgot, it was like Hitachi or something.
I had a Hitachi television.
Yeah,
yeah, I did. I think I still have I still have a tube Hitachi television in my closet somewhere.
And another thing that they really pumped on or really pushed on here was how scary shit is when it works when it's not plugged in.
Oh, yeah. They saw
the radio, the TV.
The radio, the television.
It's like, oh, it's not plugged in.
Obviously, like Pinhead was taking over the TV and stuff, too, and it wasn't plugged in.
Unplugged your TV?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's why is it unplugged? The ghosts, they were like, we're going to unplug it so that it's creepy when it comes on and it's unplugged. So there.
Yeah. The ghost, right? We got to leave it unplugged. Otherwise, we'll get interference. Come on, guys.
Pull the
plugs out of it, and then it'll be even creepier when they pan the camera.
Yeah.
That boiler room, like, slaying scene, it was pretty cool, though, with like, everything, because he is free now, and everyone, you know, the CD's getting thrown, the guys, there's, like, a bunch of pool balls in that guy's mouth. But then, like, certain people turn into, like, the Cenobites. We never saw
the camera guy, the CD. Yeah,
the camera guy.
Because this has never happened in the past, really.
We never saw his crew of Cenobites. We never saw the
dying
girl.
Are turning into Cenobites. Yeah. I don't know why that's a thing now.
Because he has to replace them.
You're right. Because
they all got taken. And then what I don't get is like the girl rolled JP up there to get eaten. Then he turns in. Then he turns him into a Cenobite. And then turns her into one.
Yeah.
I just yawned before you yawned. What the fuck's going on? We're not even in the same. We don't even see
late.
Each other.
It's getting late.
Yeah, we're only 1,600 miles away.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's just because we're connected. You know, it's meant to be at this point.
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, Scotty. It's just me and Danny kind of have a closer connection.
Does this movie, anyone else, does it sort of reek of Freddy? I mean, you have Boiler Room and then you have all this dream shit going
on. No. This movie was good.
Boiler Room, so. Dream shit. I'm just saying. Boiler Room dream shit.
And it's got the, I don't know. I don't feel free.
There's some dream his shit. Voice, they like meet in the dream and stuff.
His voice kind of, Doug Bradley's voice kind of has a similar Freddy tone to it. Kind of that deep voice. I don't know.
I would not even put this movie, this fantastic piece of cinema.
What's wrong with
Freddy? Next to Freddy Krueger.
Oh, come on.
Are you saying this is better than Freddy? Or?
Oh, yes. This is far superior to
Come
Freddy.
On. You have to at least give props to original Nightmare on Elm Street 1.
No. No, because it's
the fucking bitches. Okay,
I'm already pissed off. I'm already pissed off about that friggin' Ty and Draco and our bloggers bringing that shit up and infuriating me.
There's
just
nothing,
baiting me into a fight because everybody knows that Jason is better than Freddy Krueger.
There is nothing in, and I'm not going to argue like Jason or Freddy, which one's better, because I'm not really sure where I stand on that.
Yeah,
but
yeah, I love Freddy though, and I love Jason.
But I will say, in all of the Friday the 13th franchise and this Hellraiser franchise so far, I mean, there might be some close ones, but I don't think anything's as badass as the scene in Freddy when she's up the wall and on the ceiling getting fucking ripped apart.
I mean,
that shit's
better.
Creepy. And the bloodbath bed. Come on now.
Nah, I'm not going to get into it. I'm not going to get into it because I'm going to try to stay on topic. I'm trying to be a good.
Notice how in our chat thread,
half-ass podcast.
Notice how in our chat thread with Ty and all that, I mentioned Evil Dead and no one even dared to contend because we all know.
Evil Dead.
We're the Thompsons.
We all know we're the fucking Thompsons.
We all know Evil Dead is king.
Evil Dead, Army of Darkness, and Evil Dead 2. Our king, but right second to that is Friday the 13th.
What about Halloween?
Man, did you watch Halloween Part 6?
And really, to be honest,
Paul Rudd ruined all of the Halloweens and all that other bullshit. Even though we're all gonna be in Orlando, we got to go find some hole in the wall hepatitis filled tattoo shop to go get our thorn tattoos.
I will say though that I personally, Evil Dead is at the top. I might even go for Texas Chainsaw before I go for Halloween or Friday the 13th.
Texas Chainsaw had probably more decent ones, I guess.
I love,
because they didn't make as many of them. But see, even like the terrible chainsaws were okay. Like Chainsaw the Next Generation was still that's one of those people love to hate on. But Matthew McConaughey and Renee Zellweger, like the love robot it. Leg and all that shit was fucking great.
If you're gonna hate on any of them, just hate on two. Just keep all your hate on two.
Yeah,
because that's where it belongs.
Awful. Yeah,
and it could belong on three if Viggo Mortensen wasn't in it, because he's a badass.
Yeah. That's right, he is.
Yeah. Yep, he is.
And Halloween is up there, but only because of Tom Atkins in Part 3 in the cyborg sets.
And that has nothing to do with the storyline.
It has to do with John Carpenter not giving a shit. It's just so beautiful that Carpenter was like, I don't really care to write it, and I don't really care to direct it, and I don't really care to be a part of it, except for the check.
Yeah.
That was it.
And the check.
Look, is this going to be John Carpenter's Halloween? Yes. Do I have to do anything? No. Good. Go talk to the guy who was my set designer in 78 and have him direct this piece of shit. Oh, and get Tom Atkins. I love that mustache.
The check? The child mentioned a check?
Yeah, I do believe that there was a check supposed to be here.
That was from
it's from the musical Annie.
No, it's from The Grinch.
Oh yeah, it is from The Grinch.
Child mentioned a check. There's no check. Sorry, my wife.
Oh, who knows?
Like me and like I walk around the house quoting The Shining all day, and so my wife knows if I'm ever what's that from? Too. Her me answer too. Is always The Shining, but then she always quotes The Grinch, and so if she ever says something I'm not sure what it's from, I just go, oh, it's probably from The Grinch, and she's like, oh, how'd you know? I'm like, that's the only fucking movie you quote all day long.
It's crazy, dude. It's crazy to imagine Danny walking around quoting the ABC special Shining, which was
no quotables in that.
Stanley Kubrick.
Danny just walking around quoting Steven Weber all day long.
No quotables in that one.
Who knows though? This Hellraiser series might live up to some standards if you get through it.
There's a lot to get through.
No, there is.
But these Hellraiser to me, I do like these movies, and I did like this movie. There's like five or six really good ideas, and they had, which took about 30 minutes, and they had to figure out what to do with the other hour.
Yeah.
Because I mean, like when they escape, the Cenobites are really cool. The cigarette smoking throat girl was cool. The compact disc CD throwing DJ, and then the weird fat like bartender,
the camcorder thing,
the bartender out with the freaking like fire cocktail.
I feel bad for that bartender because he wasn't fat before he became a Cenobite. Really,
yeah.
They put like 120 pounds on that guy for like no reason whatsoever. Yep, yep. I'm sure like their dudes like, no, this is just, you know, this is just whatever. Like, are you sure this is going to look good on camera? Cause like I really worked out and got in shape to get this. Oh no, you look fine. And they roll him out like some like demonic S&M State Puff Marshmallow Man.
He did he did 6 weeks in the gym to prep for that bartender role.
Oh, you know, he did just to do the whole turn and the thing explodes and fire. And he's like, yeah, JP's girlfriend, check down there.
It's like, sir,
I nailed it, guys.
Nailed it.
I gotta call my mom. What do you mean they didn't record any sound?
Yeah.
What? All you got is
ADR all my lines?
All you got is fucking Reggie and the Yiz Dogs?
Where the fuck is William? Bill? Where is Bill? Bill's hanging over there. Bill's over there hanging out with the director's daughter.
Yeah.
Yes, so let me tell you about my guitar. 14,
by the way.
Let me tell you about this guitar.
Yeah, you know, I got this sweet acoustic guitar and 37 more payments, and that 85 El Camino is all mine. You know?
I thought you were going to say 37 more payments than I own the guitar.
Oh, this guitar.
I'm sure that guitar is a Rent-A-Center guitar. I'm sure he walked in there and was like, well, right now you could leave with this guitar for $1,250.
Oh, it was. Oh. He used to own a lot of musical equipment until. They got rid of that. Now they do layaway, and he's just not patient enough for that.
Oh, hell no.
No. So I have a feeling he's, like, sold a lot of gear on consignment. I don't know why.
We got to look him up. I mean, we really got to get him.
All right.
I know David Mays is listening. You got to get this man. You
already talked to him. They chatted online. They've had a conversation.
But you need to go back and you need to touch base with him politely. Don't sound desperate at first. Send him a couple of selfies of you, you know, just kind of emojis.
You probably first need to create a profile as if you are a 17-year-old girl.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Have you tried? Yes. There we go. Yeah. Somebody needs to get on that immediately.
So Hellraiser 3, I think we covered it.
Yeah,
nailed it.
It was pretty good.
No holes. I mean, there was some good practical effects. I mean, there's not much storyline to any of these movies. Like,
we didn't really talk about any facts. Does Scotty have some?
No, I had some, but it's kind of.
What's the budget on this thing?
The budget is $5 million, and it made $12.5 million in box office.
Okay,
ooh, that's rough.
And they actually asked Peter Jackson to direct, but. And then Peter Atkins was going to do it, but he wrote the screenplay. But some guy I never even heard of, Anthony Hickox was the one.
Yeah, he had a very strange name.
Anthony Hickox.
Hmm.
And then Clive Barker, obviously it's his, but he didn't do the screenplay. He didn't produce it. I guess it's basically just
Pinhead's his.
Yeah, Pinhead's his.
Yeah, I think they kind of hit, like this one, they definitely hit the reset button, got away from Clive Barker. Mm-hmm. And Clive Barker probably got away from it, because I think to a certain extent, you know, like Carpenter called him and was like, Clive, loved what you did. Just make sure they send you a check from now on. Yeah. Don't get all wrapped up in writing, directing, producing. You could probably get two or three more checks out of this and then just go on your way and find something else to do.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, yeah, but
just between me and you, Clive, I'm still getting checks. I don't even think they just keep writing them. Like, it's amazing.
They keep getting them. Of course, we see the triangle piece again and stuff. So we'll see how that entails into the next movies and whatnot. Of course, we haven't seen the other actresses. Maybe we'll see Kirstie again and stuff, but you never know.
Kirstie. So yeah, that was Hellraiser 3. On to Hellraiser 4. Bloodlines.
Yes.
The biggest problem that I have with the Hellraisers is it seems to be to defeat all of them, basically, you just
open the box.
You just need the puzzle box, because it can like also summon them, and then it can also like shoot them with blue light, and they just They just fucking vanish so immediately.
It should be one of those things where like you open it and they start to appear and you're like, oh fuck. And then you just redo it and then they disappear. Right.
That's what I would think. It's that simple. And so it's just, I think these movies are pretty good. I still like them.
Yeah.
But, to me, they're kind of like hangover movies almost. It's like, huh, I could watch Hellraiser 3. And you don't have to pay attention to it. You know what I mean? Like, it doesn't have to, like, you could, like, you're watching it and you blink, like, huh, she opened the box and they all vanished. Okay. Like, I don't care. I don't even need an explanation. Don't even care. Like, that worked out for me.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. It was entertaining. There was a few things like, what the fuck? But it was still good. Like, there was actually, I wrote this down and I had to say this. When she is, like, dreaming and she sees her dad as like the soldier and her dad comes up and says her name, and then obviously she knows that it's not her dad, it's Pinhead. But then she says, how'd you know my name? Like, wouldn't her dad know her name? So that was kind of weird.
Well, I mean, she died before he died before she was born.
Oh, so maybe, yeah, that's right.
But I mean if he's a ghost, I think you would let that slide.
Yeah.
Like,
I guess.
It made no sense.
I was like, wait, like, what the fuck? And then the end, though, she puts the box in the cement, and then, like, the building, the office building is built on it, and it's, like, the main symbol is the box in a bunch of places.
Which, that high def, you could totally tell was all, like, digital symbols on the wall.
Yeah, it was pretty rough. Yeah, high def didn't do the – high def made – I wish I would have had this on VHS. Yeah. It probably would have been better on VHS. Oh, like, yeah. This wasn't – this shouldn't have been – redone in high def. They should have left the shit alone.
Yeah. So what's a movie segment? What'd you watch this week?
I just watched The Beguiled today. It's pretty good. It was like a thriller, drama thriller, you know, with Colin Farrell, which that's what we were talking about. This, and then Nicole Kidman, Kirsten Dunst. It ended kind of, I wanted a little bit more when it's in theaters, right now.
Is Kirsten Dunst still hot?
It's not your little niche.
She's getting a little bit older, not as hot as she used to be, but she's still doable.
Is she still awkward looking?
Yes.
Like, does she still have that? Kirsten Dunst is one of those where you're like, huh, that's Kirsten Dunst. Like, immediately.
She's
you're
not like, really, I never found her super attractive.
Yeah. The new up-and-coming girls in it, Elle Fanning, she's been a bunch of things.
She's like
lately.
One of those. She's like, you would do her, but you wouldn't want to have a relationship. And after you did her, you would like, you wouldn't like tell people. But if they found out, like you wouldn't really care.
She's not bad.
You would just high five her and leave.
Yeah,
like, oh, man, like, that was great.
That was cool.
We're out of here.
High five.
But good game, buddy. Good game.
Same with her and what's the girl from Save the Last Dance? What's the
Oh yeah, she's not that great.
What's her name? She's in
Julia Stiles. That's it. That's what I was thinking. Like, both of those are
they're the same level.
They're
like the same level.
They're completely interchangeable.
Yeah, they are.
Dunst could have done that, and she could. But I mean, both of them have the same kind of. Huh.
I just saw
like, that's a girl.
I recently watched the newest Bourne movie where Julia Stiles dies. She dies in it.
And I quit watching those movies. I just thought to myself,
I'm like, oh, well, her career's done now because she hasn't done anything except for the Bourne movies in the longest time.
and people forget she's in them. Every time you watch a Bourne movie, like, I haven't seen a new one, but every time I've watched a Bourne movie, you're watching it and you're like, oh, there's that, in the third one, the older woman, the leader of the CIA, I can't remember her name, but she's been in a ton of stuff and I really like her. Yeah. And every time you're like, huh, that's right. Julia Stiles is in these. And but, you just immediately gloss over like you don't give a shit.
But
you're
at
like,
first you go, huh, Kirsten Dunst is in this. Then you go,
it's Julia Stiles.
Julia Stiles.
Oh, yeah, it's Julia Stiles. They look the same. Yeah, she did pretty good in this, though. It was a pretty good movie. Decent.
I thought, literally, when I saw the preview for Beguiled and I saw that Kirsten Dunst was in it, I was like, I don't know. I felt like, I was like, good for her. She hasn't done anything. Good for her.
Yeah, good. She probably had to actually audition for that role. Like, you know, like great actors like Kevin Costner, for instance, like he doesn't audition. Like, you know, they're, but like, even though these girls have been around for like 20 years, like they're still, yeah, good. She went, she woke up and got dressed and probably really, really tried to get the, good for her. I'm glad
she got the day off at the coffee shop. She went in.
Yeah. Yeah. She asked her manager. She made sure it was an excused absence.
She didn't want to be tardy, so she got an excused absence.
Not like Bill. Bill just walked. Bill doesn't have no job holding him down.
No. Nope.
Bill auditions whenever he feels like.
Oh yeah. The last thing Kirsten Dunst was in Hidden Figures. So that was 2016.
I've never
heard of that. What the hell was Hidden Figures?
It's Kevin Costner's in it. He's the main guy.
What?
Yeah.
No, what? He's not the main guy.
He's the main guy in it.
It's about the girls, the mathematician girls.
Yeah, with the rocket launching and stuff. And
who else was in that? Toby whatever from
Toby Keith.
No, not damn
Toby
it.
Toby Maguire.
From
Was it Toby Maguire in that?
No, it's the guy from The Big Bang Theory's in it, and
the other interchangeable guy.
Kirsten Dunst is in it. And then
Toby Maguire and who's the other dude that's interchangeable with him?
Jim Parsons.
No. It's Toby Maguire and the guy Topher Grace.
Oh, okay.
Topher, the guy Eric from That 70s Show, for some reason.
Oh,
him.
Yeah.
Him and Toby Maguire are completely interchangeable.
Octavia Spencer's in it. You know, they get the, all, you know, those black.
All right. Well, did you watch any other movies besides Beguiled?
I watched Moana, actually.
Actually, I did too. That's not a horror movie. Why are we talking about that?
I watched Moana. So
why did either of you watch
Moana? Well, my wife wanted to.
Oh, my God.
Hey, you know what? I liked The Rock, and it was a good movie.
Yeah, it was. It was good.
It's a cartoon.
And you know what? And you know what? There's like two parts that would scare the fucking shit out of little kids. I can't believe they put.
Yeah, it was a scary horror movie.
There's this part in Moana. They go into this underworld world under the ocean, and like she sees this masked black figure, and it turns its head towards her and crawls at her in like that stop motion possessed crawl. You know.
Oh yeah,
and it's
yeah,
all
yeah,
creepy,
yeah.
And I, of course, I mean, it didn't scare me, but I'm like, holy crap! If my kid was watching this, they'd be crying right now.
Yeah,
my daughter's watched it. I don't know how many times. I've still never seen it.
Moana, say hey. Oh,
yeah. What's the main song that the girl sings? I can't even. Whatever.
All I think about is when I try to think of it, all I hear is "Let It Go" from Frozen.
Yeah, yeah.
It's, burned into my brain.
That's burned into the brain.
How is it burned into y'all's brains? Dude, you don't have children old enough to watch that movie yet.
My wife nannied kids, and they were at my house all the time. And she was.
Oh no, we've already got you're a cradle robber. We've already, your wife just watches it at this point. That's
Yeah. that too.
Okay, so is that all your movies, Moana?
Yep.
Well, Rob, did you watch anything?
Yep.
Yeah, I watched all the Sleepaway
camps
today because I was busy.
Of course.
All of them. How long did that take you?
How many are there? How many?
Seven. There's like three. It took like 7 hours.
Holy fuck.
I mean, I was busy today, so I only had that allotted amount of time to watch really crappy 80s slasher movies.
Yeah.
All right.
And then what did I watch? Oh, I watched it a week or so ago, but I forgot to mention it. The Bye Bye Man.
Oh yeah,
which was fucking horrid.
Really? Kathleen said it was good. Kathleen said it was awesome.
The Bye Bye Man?
It was just infuriatingly just terrible.
What?
Like, I mean, it's
how
a
do
horror.
You say it's bad and my cousin says it's good?
Well, who are you going to trust?
I don't know.
I mean,
my cousin.
No, I mean, it's just the whole basis of the movie is like
you have to rent it.
There's a boogeyman called the Bye Bye Man.
Oh, and if you believe in him, then he scares you, right?
You can't say it. Don't say it. Don't think it. Don't. It's meant to be very creepy, but it comes off just so friggin' terrible. But that's like the only new one I've watched. I've watched a whole bunch of awful stuff like what's that thing on Netflix with Paul Rudd, who I hate. What is it? Oh my God.
There's the song. Okay, that's enough of that. Keep going.
I was talking about like some of like the worst things I've watched because y'all brought up something that wasn't horror, but yeah.
Cool. What is it?
I watched the series on Netflix, Wet Hot American Summer.
I've seen that.
The series.
Yeah. Not there's a series on Netflix.
Yeah, but there's a movie, an old movie.
Yeah, yeah. Well, apparently there is a movie that was made in 2001 with all the same people.
Yeah.
And holy God, is it awful?
The series?
No, the movie.
Oh, the movie.
Okay. I watched the series.
Bradley Cooper and shit.
Yeah, I watched the series and I'm like, huh. How did they make, this doesn't make much sense. They're all these really old guys and they're playing 16-year-olds. Then I found out, oh no, in 2001, they got all these actors that are huge now. Bradley Cooper, Paul Rudd, Amy Poehler, H. John Benjamin, Michael Ian Black. Yeah, that's debatable on whether or not his career is good. So I saw it on on Amazon. It was free to watch. I got about 45 minutes into it. I couldn't handle it. It was the worst thing.
I've never seen it.
There were some funny parts. Like David Hyde Pierce had a few good parts in it because he's like the
nerdy guy. I like David Hyde Pierce. Yeah. But the Netflix series is actually good. I actually really did like it after you kind of get into it. But the movie, there's a reason why the movie cost $1.8 million and it only made $180,000. That's how fucking terrible. That's it. If $1.8 million budget, Wikipedia's gross box office take was $185,000.
Wow. Oh my God, dude. That's horrible.
No, it was pretty bad. But so that was like a Bye Bye Man is just is bad. Oh, it's bad, good horror. But if you really want something to like destroy brain cells, watch Bradley Cooper getting butt raped by Michael Ian Black in a shed. That's
Wet Hot American Summer.
Bad time. All
right. I remember that. I do remember that. I've seen it. It was all right.
Of course, Scotty.
But it wasn't that great.
Butt raping.
Yeah, that's the only scene that I remember. Yeah.
Well, maybe I've watched three movies because I don't think I talked about this one. Oh no, I did. I talked about Willow Creek last time, the Bigfoot one, right?
No. I didn't hear about your Willow Creek, which is real, which is a documentary. Bigfoot is real.
A documentary.
It is. You're in Colorado. You got big feet and porcupines everywhere.
They're everywhere. They're all over the place.
That might have even been 2 weeks. I watched Willow Creek, which is shit. It might only be free if you have the Shudder subscription.
I was about to say you watched it on Shudder, didn't you?
Yeah. So, and it's actually not bad. It's like a Blair Witch style. It's a found footage style mockumentary, on Bigfoot. And yeah, it's just this couple that follows, tries to find Bigfoot, and it's pretty good. It has a unique scene in it. It has a 20-minute scene of just, it's straight one shot. They did it in one take, because there's no cuts or anything. So it's literally just them in the tent reacting to noises. It's the middle of the night, and they're reacting to noises outside the tent. And that's it. There's barely any lines. They're just looking around.
Really?
A noise happens. They look at each other. They say a couple lines. They continue looking around. And this goes on for about 20 minutes. And
nice.
Yeah, and it sounds stupid as fuck. But when you watch it, it's not too bad. There are a couple times you're like, is this going to be ending soon? And it's not too horrible that you're wading through it, but it's pretty cool. It's not bad. It's a decent movie. It's probably worth the watch. Willow Creek.
Check it out. Shudder.
I also finally watched 31, which
ha! You bought into it too. 31. You couldn't help yourself.
Rob Zombie's newest film.
Oh, I haven't seen it yet.
Is it really a film? Are we really going to call that a film?
Know. It was just, I just can't.
Nazis running around speaking Spanish.
Okay.
Are we going to call that a film, sir?
It actually was better. It was a little better than I thought it was going to be, but I just can't really watch anything anymore that is made by him and has Sherry Moon in the leading role.
Was she leading role again?
I just can't.
Of course she was. Of course she was the leading fucking role.
And I really hate that I can't do that because I still haven't seen Lords of Salem and I sort of want to sit through it. And I don't know. I just can't. it just irks me that she's the leading role and he made it every single fucking time.
I'm coming to you as a friend. You don't have to watch Lords of Salem.
Have you seen it, Rob?
Like, oh God, yes. I even went back and after all of the comments that I got about, oh, the Rob's unfair to Rob Zombie. He's a genius.
I think.
What about Lords of Salem? That's all I heard. That's all I heard was, what about Lords of Salem, Rob? What about Lords of Salem, Rob? I went back and rewatched that piece of shit. I have now lost 3 hours of my life just in Lords of Salem. And in 31, I was even like, I'll give it a shot. I warned everybody not to watch that movie. It's so friggin' terrible.
It was, I don't know, a little weird and far. It was just off the wall. But there were some good kills. There were some good kills.
But you had to wade through so much of Sherry Moon Zombie talking.
And I know Rob Zombie gets the... I know you hate him, but I love Devil's Rejects, and I don't mind the new Halloweens. So there you have it.
Such crap.
All right.
You know Halloween.
There you have it.
At least give it up. You know H2 was so bad. You know it was, and you just won't admit it.
It infuriates me so much. I like burly bearded Jason, or Michael. So... and get Rob, at least meet me on Jason this one too. At least meet me on this one. Devil's Rejects, come on.
Devil Rejects was actually where all of his stupid bull crap actually kind of was funny and kind of worked, like the whole thing with the sheriff and Elvis Aaron Presley, you know, don't you ever, you know, that was funny. That actually all kind of worked, but it worked the one time. You can't keep doing the same thing.
It's very true. He needs to change it up big time next time.
Yep.
Because everything he's ever done has to do with circuses and weird fucking people.
Yeah. Yeah.
What are we going to do with this? I'm kind of like Hellbilly Circus. They won't see it coming. I know what you're thinking. I know what you're thinking. Rob. You've done it before with the 1,000 corpses, Devil's Rejects, after you ass raped Halloween all over the place. And you know what? But see, they're not going to be expecting it this time. They're just not. They're not going to see it. It's going to come right out of left field. Fucking dickhead.
And I watched one more. Right before we started this recording, I watched Maniac Cop. I've never seen it before.
Tom Atkins.
What year was that?
You know what? Amazon had it wrong because it said 2011, so I don't know what year it was. It's probably early 90s.
I think late it's in 80s. The 80s, though.
It probably is in the 80s. You got Tom Atkins and Bruce Campbell and little Danny Hicks action.
Nice.
Yeah, it was good.
1988 was Maniac Cop.
Just looking it up, you could beat me.
It was very 80-ish, but it was good. It was good. Bruce Campbell, fresh off of... or in between the Evil Deads, basically. Between Evil Dead
and Army of Darkness.
Two and Army of Darkness, yeah. Right?
Nice.
Yeah, that was an ouch of a movie.
The budget
was $1 million and the box office was $600,000.
Wow. Was that Wikipedia? Jeez.
Because I think
that movie's hard to watch. I watched that movie and was kinda like, okay. Tom Atkins is in it. I just kept telling myself Tom Atkins is in it.
Wasn't bad. I think Bruce Campbell does okay.
No, he did. Bruce Campbell did good.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, no. Bruce Campbell and Tom Atkins make the movie.
Yeah.
Like you don't give a shit about the Maniac Cop or anybody else. And you just care about Tom Atkins.
Yeah. The rest were sort of like the blonde cop girl. She was pretty bad. And I don't know. Yeah. It was okay. It was a decent movie.
You feel kind of bad for Bruce because they didn't give him much to work with in that movie.
And a lot of you people are like, oh, Evil Dead fan is, and you just saw Maniac Cop now. Well, as I reiterated to Rob before we started this episode.
Which you guys can hear if you join the Patreon.
He reiterated to me too.
Which
I was listening.
Which is
Scotty was there. We all know you were there, Scotty. Yeah. We weren't trying to cut you out.
What I said is that I am a hardcore Evil Dead franchise fan, not a hardcore Bruce Campbell fan. I'm not one of those guys that's like, I love Evil Dead, so now I have to watch and follow every single thing that Bruce Campbell does. Like I'm more of a huge fan of the Evil Dead franchise than just Bruce Campbell. So that's why
you still got all upset when I said that RoboCop was cooler than Sam Raimi. So.
That's because Sam Raimi is a fucking genius with everything he does.
I could put Spider-Man in there and just ruin your day.
Well, I guess, okay, anything related, Spider-Man wasn't bad, but anything related to horror in any way is awesome. Let's say that.
No, just, Raimi.
You can tell it's Sam Raimi.
Yeah, Raimi, he did.
I mean, Drag Me to Hell was fucking genius.
That's what it was.
Drag Me to Hell, awesome movie.
I had no idea that Raimi did Drag Me to Hell. I just stumbled across it and said, let's watch it. And immediately, like 5 minutes in, I'm like, did Sam Raimi? What the fuck? Did Sam Raimi do this movie? I had to go.
It was good. the shooting style, the gimmicks, everything that Sam Raimi personally has most control over, you're like, oh, this is Sam Raimi.
That was the movie I was thinking, because me and Savannah were watching it long time ago when it came out. I got it like at a Redbox or something back when you rented movies, not on your TV. Kids, there was a time where you actually had to go to a store, not just a box outside of a 7-Eleven, to find movies to rent. But I do remember watching, like, this is just so familiar for some reason. And then I Googled it, and I was like, oh, it hit me. I'm like, it's got to be Sam Raimi. And then, of course, the goat scene and all that. It was just awesome.
Yep.
And so, when Raimi's just being himself and not having to deal with Marvel or whatever for Spider-Man, because he only has so much control.
But when
he's behind the camera and he's telling them what to do, it's awesome. It's always awesome.
Yeah. He's great.
Well, shit. We're like an hour and a half here now or something. Jesus. All right. We'll wrap it up.
We will wrap this up.
So, check out. We're going to start doing some pre-show recordings on the Patreon, so you don't want to miss that. Check out the website, coldclassichorror.com. Follow us everywhere, Cold Classic Horror.
Twitter, Instagram, Face Chat, all that stuff.
Snapchat.
We're all about the Face Chats.
Face Chats, Snapbook.
Still new on Snapchat. So we're there. Our username is CCH Podcast. So check it out.
Do it.
Thank you guys for joining us. We'll catch you next week.
Later, guys.
Laters.
Don't you blame the movies! Movies don't create psychos! Movies make psychos more creative!
Oh yes. There will be blood.